Спільно гуманітарний факультет і факультет політико-інформаційного менеджменту підготували міжнародний проєкт в рамках грантової програми від Вишеградського фонду. І цей проєкт пов'язаний із викладанням курсу, що має назву «Комперативні студії демократизації. Транзитивна політика в країнах Вишеградської четвірки і Україні». І в рамках цього курсу будуть запрошувані професори із країн Вишеградської четвірки, зокрема із трьох країн – це із Чехії, із Словаччини і Польщі. І сьогодні нашим гостем є професор із Карлового університету, директор Інституту політології Карлового університету Петр Юпнер. І він от розкаже в рамках цього курсу кейс Чехословаччини, Чехословаччини спочатку, згодом Чехії, як однієї з країн, яка є членом Вишеградської четвірки і яка теж пройшла свій шлях демократизації і транзиту, демократичного транзиту. Тому я передаю слово для Петра Юпнера. Прошу.
Thank you very much, Professor Shevchuk. I would slowly begin. First of all, I would briefly introduce my university. I make it very quickly. So the I heard or I was informed that the National Ostroh Academy is the oldest university in Eastern Europe. We are good partners because the Charles University in Prague is the oldest university in Middle Europe. We were founded 1348 by Charles IV, and now we have approximately 54,000 students in 17 faculties. So we are covering all disciplines, included theology, for example. According some interpretations, the Charles University is also the oldest German university, because till 1409 the university was managed by council where Saxony or Bavaria had representatives. Degree from our universities had, for example, also Albert Einstein or Franz Kafka. According to university ranking, we are the university number 3 in Central Europe. In political science, where I'm from, we are between the place 150 and 200 in the world, which is a good result. Charles University has only approximately 16 disciplines, where we are between 150 and 200. It's quite hard because there are many American or West European universities. And we are comparable, for example, with some German universities. Here you can find the website, the link to the website of our Faculty of Social Sciences. And I'm from the Institute of Political Studies. When you follow this link, you should switch into English. Our institute has approximately 1,000 students. We have three departments focused on political science, international relations, and security studies. And we also offer a study in English. We have some master programs in English for those who already have some other master or bachelor. We offer geopolitical studies, international security studies, master in international relations, and also international economic and political studies. And now we are working a new study program, bachelor degree, politics, philosophy, and economy. It's also possible to make PhD studies in our institute in political science, or international relations, and it's quite attractive. The Charles University is interested that we have more students from our countries, and the fee for PhD studies is not so high. It's approximately 500 euro for a semester, and these students receive also scholarships. We have also many partners worldwide, and we are negotiating also about the cooperation with the National Ostrov Academy. So now something about the structure of the lectures. I would start especially with the transition to democracy, with the informations what happened or with the interpretation what happened in 1989 in Czechoslovakia. And then I would follow with the topic of the Czech constitution, how the new constitution was designed. I expect I will not be able to cover more topics than these two. And tomorrow I would follow with subnational government. What is my personal research focus is also, it has also relation to the Czech constitution, and I would say subnational government or subnational self-government or decentralization, this is something what is very, very important for democracy, and that is why it's also important regarding the transition. And topic which is really attractive is the partisan politics, political parties. It's something what is probably more interesting than constitution. So this is something what I will speak tomorrow. So now I would start about the way to democracy. The most important issues happened in the former Czechoslovakia in 1989. I'm from the Czech Republic. You know that there was Czechoslovakia till which year? 1990. So from 1993 we have Czech Republic and Slovakia. So when we speak about transition, it's very important to speak about 1989, and at that time we still had Czechoslovakia. At the constitution of Czechoslovakia was mentioned that there is a leading role of the Communist Party, and the political actor was the so-called National Front. National Front nominated the candidates for people's committees or for the parliament, and the National Front consisted from the Communist Party, from some satellite parties, and from various associations, like, for example, women, sportsmen, etc. On subnational levels, public administration was based on so-called people's committees, and on all levels there were there were quasi elections. So we had elections. But it wasn't possible to change anything because only the National Front nominated the candidates. So there was no choice to choose some other candidates than from the National Front. It wasn't possible to vote secret, and it wasn't obligatory that everyone should come to the elections. But it was very hard not to participate on the elections. So voter turnout in the parliamentary elections in 1986 was more than 99%. On one side, the Czechoslovakian regime in 1989 was quite conservative. What happened at that time in this year in Hungary, Poland or Eastern Germany, so the Czechoslovakian communist state, quite conservatives. There were no reform initiatives in Czechoslovakia inside the Communist Party. On the other side, the communist ideology was not so strong anymore at that time. Some people say goulash communism. So important was the system, not the ideology. And of course, at that time in this year, we had also economic problems, and there was also problem with clientelism, corruption. So the image of the regime wasn't good at that time. What is very important for the transition. For that, what happened in 1989 in the Czech Republic, it's very important to see what happened in other countries, also in the Visegrad countries, in Central Europe. Important is the geopolitical context. There was a very close cooperation between Czechoslovakia or between the communist parties in the Central European countries and the Soviet Union. The pressure of the Soviet Union was very important, and it's very important to remember that in the time of Mikhail Gorbachev, in the time of Perestroika, and in the time of Glasnost, there was no pressure anymore. So it was completely new situation. The communists in all Central European countries they were following the Soviet Union, and the communist representatives in the Soviet Union. But it happened in the 80s that, for example, in Czechoslovakia, the Czechoslovakian communists were more conservative than Gorbachev in the Soviet Union. So we can say the Czechoslovakian some communists had the feeling they stayed alone, they don't have help anymore, and it was very important for the development in the year 1989. What is very important for the there were no free media before 1989, but it was visible for the Czechs and Slovaks what happened in other countries. There were elections in Poland where Solidarność won in the same year. There were some liberal changes in Hungary, and very important was the development in Eastern Germany. That was very important. And it was especially visible. For example, some citizens from Eastern Germany tried to escape from Eastern Germany to Western Germany. It was very hard. Many people were shot on the border at the wall of Berlin. But during 1989, the border between Hungary and other countries in Central Europe didn't work so well, and many citizens of Eastern Germany tried to escape to Western Germany on that way, that they went to Prague, to the capital of Czechoslovakia, and they try to reach the garden of the West German embassy. There were approximately 3,000-4,000 people in the quite small garden of the embassy of Western Germany in Prague, and the police controlled the situation, but many people tried to reach the embassy over the wall, etc. And the center of Prague, of the capital of Czech Republic, was full of Trabant, you know, the car produced in Eastern Germany. So it was visible for the Czech people what happens. And shortly before that what happened in Czechoslovakia was also the fall of the wall of Berlin. So in November 1989, we were in the situation that we everyone is on the way to democracy, and Czechoslovakia was something like a conservative island. And in this situation, November 17 is important day in Czechoslovakia. It is something like student day. And every year in November 17, the people and especially students remembered what happened in November 17 in 1939, when the Nazis closed the Czechoslovakian universities, and they killed some student representatives. For example, Jan Opletal. So that is why there was a demonstration on November 17, but the plan was not that it will be a demonstration against the communist regime. It had to be student celebration to remember what happened in the beginning of the Second World War. But during these demonstrations, there were many students. They started to call for freedom. They were not satisfied with the speakers from the Communist Party, and a few thousand students tried to get to Wenceslas Square. It's the main square in Prague. It wasn't plan of the demonstration that they will take this route. And during they tried to get to Wenceslas Square, they were calling for freedom. They were brutally stopped by the police in the National Street. It was very, very hard. And nobody was surprised about the information that a student called Martin Schmid was killed during this attack of the police. What is interesting, it wasn't true. So it didn't happen that student called Martin Schmid would be killed. But it was in the Western media, and at that time it was too much for the people. So during the next day, November 18, there were two activists who visited Prime Minister Adamec. And they offered him that they will negotiate about the power, that it's too much and it's important to change the regime. And there were also two students, two girls, visiting the Prime Minister in his flat. And the girls tried to explain him that it was a brutal attack, and the Prime Minister expressed he didn't know that it was so hard. At the same day, the students tried to create committees, and very important role played actors from theaters. So they stopped playing theaters. And instead of playing theater, they read to the people visiting theaters declaration related to what happened one day before. In November 19, Civic Forum was created. Civic Forum was transformed into the political party, participate in the elections 1990 and won the elections. So this Civic Forum was created 2 days after November 17. During the late evening, approximately 300 representatives of various initiatives, student committees, theaters, met and created this platform, which was this political platform, which was very important for the negotiations and also for the elections in 1 year later in 1990. Many things happened in 2 weeks after November 17. For example, there was a decision about a general strike in November 27. This general strike showed that the support, that the call for changes is very, very, very strong, and that they are not only students and not only actors calling for freedom and calling for changes, but in the fact it's complete society. They are also workers in the factories who want to change the system. In the days after November 17, heads of the General Committee of the Communist Party gave up, so there were some personal changes, but there were no changes of the system, there were personal changes, and there were negotiations between the communist representatives, like Prime Minister Adamec on one side. The Prime Minister Adamec wasn't a part of the hard group of the Communist Party, so he was as a communist relative liberal and open for discussions. And on the other side was the civic forum. In the first days, the communists were not able, or didn't agree that they would speak about the later president Václav Havel. Václav Havel was in prison for some times before, and for the communists it was quite hard to negotiate with somebody who was in their prison. So in the first days they rejected to speak with him. So when the first delegation of Civic Forum visited the communist representatives, Václav Havel was waiting for the result, but the pressure was very, very strong, and by the next negotiations the later president Václav Havel personally was there by the negotiations and was leading the negotiations with the communist representatives. What was also very, very important were the demonstrations in Letná. Do we have some football fans here?
Yes.
Do you know some football teams in Czech Republic?
Slavia
is the best, you are right, but there is another football team, Sparta. And so next to the Sparta Prague stadium in Letná, there is a big place, and there were demonstrations in Letná. The advantage of this big place is that they could meet many people, and according some estimations, approximately 50,000 people demonstrated there two times, and it was very hard for the communists because it was very visible that something must happen. Prague has more than 1 million inhabitants, and there demonstrated 750,000 people. So it was very hard, and important were also media. In the first days after November 17, there were no informations for the people. the people were informed, some people had informations from the radios Free Europe or Voice of America, for example. But what is very important, there were also changes in Czech TV, for example, and the Czech TV started to inform very open about the development, what happened. And for example, these demonstrations in Letná were in the TV. So all important speakers of the opposition, all the student representatives, so everybody who was speaking there to the people was also in the Czech TV. So there was an open discussion, and at that time it was clear that that it's not possible to stop these changes. And according to the results of the negotiations, the communists started to make changes of the constitution. So regarding the topics in the discussion in the negotiations at that time in these weeks, very important was the topic of the year 1968. You know what happened in Czechoslovakia in 1968? No.
Prague Spring,
yes. What is it, Prague Spring? What it was? So when we say Prague Spring, it's a title for a series of concerts of classical music. But you are absolutely right. Prague Spring is also title for something what happened in the end of 60s in the late 60s in Czechoslovakia.
There were, as I know, there were some Soviet forces. They introduced tanks, and there were some just.
So I think it was quite clear. There was a big and strong reform or reformist movement in the Communist Party in Czechoslovakia in late 60s. The people called it something like socialism with people's with human face or something like this. So the people were quite happy about the regime in the late 60s. But our communists were too liberal for the Soviet Union and for the other countries. The development in the Czechoslovakia would be dangerous inspiration for other countries, and that is why Czechoslovakia was in the August 1968 was Czechoslovakia occupied from the armies of the other members of so-called Warsaw Pact or Warsaw Treaty. So it means from the Soviet Union and also Poland, Eastern Germany, Hungary, etc. So it can happen that also people from here, soldiers from here, from Ukraine, were in Czechoslovakia at that time. And the hardcore or something like a Stalinist core of the Communist Party in 1968 wasn't happy about the development in late 60s, and approximately five representatives of Communist Party invited, in the fact they wrote a letter to the representatives of the Soviet Union, and they invited them, they pushed them to make something. And in 1989 it was very important for the dissidents for the society to solve this issue. They wanted that it's important to say clearly that's absolutely wrong what happened in 1968. So it was an important topic for the discussion. It's also important regarding the actors of the changes, because many of the dissidents in 1989 were actors of the politics in 1968 and had problems after the Prague Spring, after what happened in 1968. There was a requirement of the opposition that there shouldn't be the political prisoners should be free, people who are arrested from political reasons. There was a clear requirement that it should be investigated who gave the commands for the police attack in Národní třída on November 17. The requirement was also the requirements were also focused on the constitution changes, especially on the statement that the Communist Party has the leading role in the constitution system. It was similar to the Soviet Union, because in these countries like Soviet Union or Czechoslovakia, not only the constitution bodies or institutions were important, like parliament, like government, but especially the Communist Party bodies were important, and it is why it was important to change it in the constitution that Communist Party doesn't play a leading role in the system. And of course the final and the most important requirement of the opposition and of the civic forum, which wasn't clear in the beginning in the first negotiations, was focused on free elections. Everything what I'm speaking about happened very, very quickly. It was very, very quick. Nobody expected that it will be so quick. The opposition didn't expect that it will be so easy. The communists were surprised. They also didn't expect it will be so quick. And already in December 1989, Alexander Dubček was elected as a chairman of the parliament. Alexander Dubček was one of the people from 1968. He was a chairman of the central committee of the general committee of the Communist Party. So in the fact, he was something like prime minister in that time, as Czechoslovakia was occupied by the Soviet Union and by the armies of the Soviet Union and other countries, and he was a symbol of this positive development in late 60s. So he was elected as a chairman of the parliament. Interesting was that the communists, that there were still communists in the parliament, but even when the parliament was full of communists, they elected Dubček as a chairman, and Václav Havel was elected still by the communist parliament. So the communists completely in the parliament completely changed their meaning. Everything changed. During few nights, few days, and even in the end of December, Václav Havel was elected by the parliament for president. president is in the was not so important in the constitutional system even before 1989, but it was a very very visible change, and it was clear that the changes will be completed during after three elections in a few months. When we should speak about the actors of the transition, very important were students. Students were in the beginning. I mentioned the big students demonstration. The students created committees. The student spoke about the changes in their secondary schools. At the universities, they tried to visit people in the factories, and they tried to explain to the people what's happened. And it is important to change something. Very important were actors in the theaters. So there were in the beginning they were important because the people and various committees met in the theaters. They didn't play in the theaters. They just explained to the people that is important to change something. And as I said, that the dissidents were traveling into regions and were explaining to the people in the factories, for example, that we are going to change something. It was very important that they were actors, because the people knew actors from TV, from movies, so they were popular. And when a delegation from Prague comes to factory in some forgotten region, it's very important that there is somebody who they know from TV, for example. So that was very important. And for example, there is an actor Bartoška. He was something like a lover. He was an idol for women in the Czech Republic. He acted in many Czech movies. Now he's very very old, and he's responsible for some film event in Karlovy Vary. And this actor Bartoška was leading the first negotiation of the Civic Forum and of the dissident instead of Václav Havel, for example. Very important were dissidents, so people who were against the regime, and people who didn't start the activities in 1989, people who worked a longer time on a longer time on changes, people who copied some secret materials, they were distributing some illegal newspapers, etc. So these people were demonstrating also in the years before 1989, but they were not so strong to change something. But at this time they took the chance to change something. And very important were also pragmatic communists. As I said, there was no strong reform or a reformist movement inside of the Communist Party, so the Communist Party wasn't able to reform the system, to reform the state, or to reform the party. But when the communists saw what happened, there were many pragmatic people in the communist party who felt or who had the impression now it's time to cooperate on the changes, now it's time to help. And these pragmatic communists were cooperating on the changes together with dissidents, actors and students. For example, Marian Čalfa, was appointed as a minister or prime minister even before Václav Havel was elected for president, and it was the cooperation between him and between Václav Havel was very important for the development. When we speak about dissidents, very important is a distinction, or we could say rivality, between the so-called new dissidents. So, for example, Václav Havel wasn't one of the people of 1968. So the new dissidents, they were more radical. They didn't believe that it's possible to reform communism. They were sure that it's important to change the regime completely, and that we couldn't stay in a communist country. On the other side, there were many dissidents from so-called people from 1968. In some cases, they were former politicians, former representatives of the communist regime till 1968, and these people were also requiring changes. They were also calling for free elections, but these people still believed on socialism or communism. They still believed that that the state could work like in the late 60s. And we have to expect that there were conflicts between these two groups. But these conflicts were clear in the next years. For that what happened in 1989 or 1990, it wasn't important. But it's important for the next election in 1992. Tomorrow we will speak about the partisan politics and about the development later. So what happened in the next year? Parliament elections were organized in June 1990, half year after what happened in November and December. In these elections, Civic Forum won the elections. Many other democratic parties won representation in the parliament. And in autumn 1990, there were also local elections. So we can say it was all very quick. And during 1 year, all the changes of the regime were completed. So when we speak about transition to democracy in the political theory, can you tell me some? Can you mention any author or expert who was dealing with theory of transitions to the democracy? I heard something about Stepan. Does somebody know the theory of Karl and Schmitter? You make the impression you know it. Okay, so I will not explain it, but I will just briefly mention that there are some authors dealing with transitions to democracy, and according Stepan, the reason of the transition or the form of the transition in the Czech Republic or Czechoslovakia was pressure from society, and according Karl and Schmitter, we could say that that the transition to democracy was a reform, not pact, not a revolution. It was a reform, and in this concept, the reform is linked to the principle that it was a bottom-up initiative or a bottom-up pressure. So this is a link to the theory. What you can check later, or in the theoretical literature, or in the sources, for example. So I think I have some pictures in the presentation to make it more attractive. So this is a picture from the demonstration in November 17. The police stopped the students. There were the national street, Národní třída in Czech, was completely closed. There were many people on a small place, and in the beginning, the students were singing. The girls gave flowers to the policemen. They were expressing that don't want to use power or make conflicts, but then the police got command that they should attack the students, and it was very hard. So this is a picture from the beginning where the attack still didn't start. What is important, it wasn't normal police. There were special troops focused on hard situations. How I said, nobody died during the attack, but it was very hard. And till now, there are some theories or some expectations that probably somebody died during the attack. But nobody knows some concrete case. And you know that it was a student demonstration. It was the people had to remember what happened 1939. But the students were prepared to call for freedom. And you see, svoboda. It's good to understand also in Ukrainian. So there are also some emotional pictures from Národní třída. So in the beginning there was a very good atmosphere, but then the attack of the police came. So this is a picture of Alexander Dubček. He was, as I said, in the end of 1989, he was elected as a chairman of the Czechoslovakian parliament. And on this picture, he's speaking to the people during the demonstration in Letná. This is a part of the Sparta Prague stadium. So he's speaking from the stadium. And this is the demonstration where I said it was completely in the TV, and there is an expectation there were approximately 750,000 people demonstrating there, and there were many speakers during the hours. Not only Alexander Dubček, but also Václav Havel, for example, and also Miloš Zeman, the current president of the Czech Republic. So this is a picture of the negotiation. This is the so-called time of round tables. So they called it round tables. Many times met the delegation of the communist party or of the communist regime on one side, and the civic forum on the other side. As I said, in the first moments, the communist delegation or the communist representatives didn't accept that Václav Havel will be a leader of the delegation or will participate on the meeting, but it changed it, and you can see a picture of one of the meetings. I think it was the first meeting where Václav Havel was the leader of the delegation, and it was a symbolic picture and a symbolic moment that they shake the hand and they speak with each other. And regarding the form of the transition, you see Marian Chalfa. He was a representative of the regime, representative of the communist government. But on the other side, he was very, very pragmatic, and he was prime minister also in the time. After the changes, and he had close cooperation with Václav Havel. So for the transition, for the changes, it was very important that also people from the other side cooperated with the civic forum. So, and this is the picture from the end of the December 1989. After Václav Havel was elected for the Czechoslovakian president, and after the election he was elected by the parliament, he comes to the balcony of the Prague Castle in Prague, and there are many people celebrating this election. So, some emotional pictures. So, and now, before we start with the topic of the constitution, Any questions? Was everything clear?
Yeah.
I don't think it was clear. I know that I have problem with my English. I speak better German. So don't. So you are free to ask me to explain anything better. So, okay, so we would start the next session or the next topic. There is a link between transition of one side and between the constitution and constitutional change on the other side. We can speak about two periods. One period is from the time of the transition, 1989 till 1992. And the second period is from 1992 or 1993. Important is that in this time, in the first period, we still have the constitution of Czechoslovakia. Czechoslovakia was still not divided on Czech Republic and Slovakia. And in this period, there were many constitutional changes, so the constitution was changed many times, but it was still the old constitution. It wasn't a completely new constitution of the state. We just speak about modifications of the old communist constitution. And during 1992, is clear that Czechoslovakia will be divided into Czech Republic and Slovakia, and the Slovaks, so as Czechs, has had to start to work on constitution, and that is why we got from the January 1993 in the Czech Republic completely new constitution. So important is that we mention these two periods, and important is to understand the difference between the development of the constitution before 1992 and after 1992. So when we speak about the first period, there were approximately 12 changes of the old communist constitution, and since 1968 1969 Czechoslovakia was a federation. So there were federal or federative principles implemented into the constitutions approximately more than 20 years ago. So Czechoslovakia had three parliaments: the Czechoslovakian parliament, the Czech parliament, and the Slovak parliament. So it was till the end. Till the end of Czechoslovakia, and the Czechoslovakian parliament consisted of two chambers, chambers of people and chamber of nations. And in the chamber of nations, the representation in the chamber of nations was 50-50. Czechs and Slovaks, even if there were much more Czechs and than Slovaks in the Czechoslovakia. The constitution, the old communist constitution, expected that also in the Czechoslovakia there will be not only the Czechoslovakian constitution, but also Czech and Slovak constitution will be created. But it never happened during the time of the Czechoslovakia, and the fact that it never happened was very important for the later development. So when we speak about the discussions in this first period, very important are the discussions between Czechs and Slovaks. It was very hard to agree on something because when some law proposal had to be approved by the parliament, it was necessary that both chambers agree with the law proposal, and so it wasn't possible to agree on any law proposal without the Slovaks, without the other part of Czechoslovakia. And there were many discussions between Czechs and Slovaks about the future structure of the state, about the title of the state, for example. If I should explain it better, so we can in general say that communism was for the people something like religion. The people believed in the communism, and in the communism the question of nations were not important at all. And after the fall of communism, the people were searching what is important. And they were searching for some old traditions, for some old ideas, and you saw also in the former Soviet Union, or also in the former Yugoslavia, that it happened also in other countries. It happened also in the Czech Republic. And the Slovaks were trying to improve their position in the state, and that is why there were discussions about the name of the state. For example, if it should be Czechoslovakia or Czechoslovakia. So there were many discussions, especially on that topic, which seems not to be important for the transition, but I think it's very important for the transition in countries with many nations, I think it's important to speak about it. Something important happened in 1992. We had elections in Czechoslovakia, and it happened that different political party. There were partly different parties in the Czech part and in the Slovak part of the state. So we had a little bit different party system. It happened that two different parties won the elections. In the Czech Republic won Civic Democratic Party of Václav Klaus, and in Slovakia won Hnutí za demokratické Slovensko, something like Movement for Democratic Slovakia of Vladimír Mečiar. And these two parties and these two politicians had a different meaning about the future development of the Czechoslovakia. They had also different positions on the reform of the economy. There were different situations with unemployment, for example, in Czech Republic and Slovakia. And the Movement for Democratic Slovakia had in the program even before the elections that Czechoslovakia shouldn't be a federation anymore, but something like confederation. And the Czechs rejected these ideas because they said confederations would be something like Slovakian independence for Czech money. But after the elections in 1992, there was a negotiation between these two parties, between Vladimír Mečiar and Václav Klaus, and the result of this negotiation was that Czechoslovakia will be divided. So there was no referenda about this solution. We could say that especially the Czechs didn't understand why it must happen. On the other side, the Czechs saw that when it's a wish of the Slovak nation, it must be done. And on the other side, in Slovakia, there were different meanings. So there were people for people who wanted to have Czechoslovakia, people who wanted independence, and also people who wanted something between. But we can say that the initiative for the independent Slovak and Czech state came from the Slovakian side, and that is why especially the Slovaks started to work on their constitution. They didn't had a constitution in the time of Czechoslovakia, so they start very quickly to work on the constitution. And also the Czechs were in the situations that they had to work on the constitution because the agreement between the Czechs and Slovaks was that since January 1st, 1993, Czech Republic will be an independent state. And these elections were in June 1992. So it was a hard work in a short time. And on the new constitution, and there were two committees appointed for a constitution. One committee was appointed by the government, and another committee was appointed by the parliament. We can say there were often politicians in these two committees, but there were also experts on law in these committees. It is very important, and many authors are mentioning that there were also people with some general authority and with some influence on the discussion of the new institution. For example, the Czech president Václav Havel, who tried to participate on the discussions on the new government, how I said, there wasn't Czech constitution in the time of Czechoslovakia, so the task was to create completely new constitution, and it successfully happened. Part of the new constitution was a list of human rights. So the list of human rights has the position of the constitutional law or of the constitution. It's interesting that, for example, Václav Klaus, the former Czech president, wasn't happy or rejected the idea that list of human rights will be a part of the will be a part of the constitution, but it was approved that it will be a part of the constitution. The new constitution has an introduction, and in this introduction there is a declaration of basic values of the new state, and the experts speak about participation of Václav Havel on the text of the introduction. For example, there is no religion mentioned in this introduction, so it's a constitution of atheistic state or in the or of state where is there is no state religion. I shouldn't say atheistic state, and there isn't a nation mentioned in the constitution. So it's a constitution for people, for citizens, not for nations. And there is also term of civic society in this introduction. This term, civic society, doesn't occur in the text of the constitution. Only in this introduction, and is a term often used by Václav Havel. So a very important source for the on one side, it was a completely new constitution. It wasn't a constitutional change, but it was a completely new constitution. But very important. But this constitution had very important source. A very important source for this constitution was constitution from the so-called First Republic, 1919 till 1938, it was based on constitution from 1920. So when we compare this old constitution from the First Republic, so there is lots of inspiration, and this constitution from 1920 was a very, very important source, and it's very visible also according some books and some books of the actors of the negotiations of 1992, when there is a transition, some country is on the way to democracy, is very, very important to have some tradition, to have some sources. So mostly the countries who don't have it, their situation seems to be harder. Of course, the constitution is based on a division of powers. There is also subnational self-government mentioned. I will speak about it later. And the Czech Republic was similar to the First Republic, and similar to Czechoslovakia was the constitution the system was based on parliamentary system. So in the Czech Republic and Czechoslovakia there is a long tradition of parliamentary, not presidential system. So we had in the beginning indirect election of the president. Executive body was the government with the prime minister, and of course parliament, the third important body of the constitution. It seems to be a little bit strange. I think it's a question on you, who is visible for you as a part of Czech politics, the prime minister or the president? Do you know when you think about it, are the prime ministers more better visible for you or the presidents? The presidents. Some other meaning? Yeah. Prime Minister?
Yeah.
Who is the Czech Prime Minister right now?
I know the president.
Yeah, but you know the president.
But I know the name of the President Miloš Zeman now, but I don't know the name of your prime minister.
Yeah. So I think that's quite typical. It's very important that you that you expressed your impression. Probably it looks strange because I said that president is head of the state. He don't have executive powers or executive responsibility. The executive body is the government with the prime minister. But nobody knows the prime minister, and all of you know the complicated personality of our president. So it's important to say that, for example, Václav Havel expected, or his meaning was that the role of the president in the constitution should be stronger. It was his meaning, but the constitution is but there is no executive power linked to the president in the constitution, but when you see who was the Czech president, Václav Havel, Václav Klaus, and now Miloš Zeman, so these politicians had all of these three presidents had authority in the system. He was trying to have influence on what happens also in the party politics. So Václav Havel was a very strong personality and very strong actor actor after 1989. Václav Klaus was for a long time prime minister and chairman of the Civic Democratic Party, and Miloš Zeman was also prime minister in the social democratic government. So we every time had a strong president, stronger leader, and that is why our presidents are very visible for you, but it doesn't respond to the constitution. According our constitution, the executive body is the government with the prime minister, and the president has no he's not responsible for that what he does. So it means he doesn't have executive powers. So on the other side, he's very loud and very visible abroad. So it's very complicated for people in Germany, in Ukraine, to explain or to understand the Czech politics or the Czech position on what happens in international relations, because you often don't know the position of the Czech government, which is important. And on the other side, and of course it's very important and very symbolic, you know the position of the president, but it's not linked with the official foreign policy of the Czech government. So this is something what is hard to understand, and it's important to show that in the fact it works a little bit different than according to constitution. So it's not a problem in the Czech Republic, but when you observe the situation from the perspective of Ukraine, Germany, or other countries, it's quite complicated. So our parliament has two chambers, chambers of deputies and senate. It's an asymmetric parliamentarism, so most important is the Chamber of Deputies. We have 200 deputies. We have these 200 deputies are elected by a proportional election system. The seats are divided with D'Hondt method in 14 election districts for 4 years. We have proportional election system, but some of the election districts are quite small. So the relation between the number of votes and number of seats is by strong parties or big parties sometimes much better than by small parties, for example. We have the other chamber of the parliament is Senate. We have 81 senators. They are elected by two-round majority system for 6 years, and every 2 years, 27 senators are elected. This system seems to be quite complicated for the Czech voters. Many Czech voters think it's quite expensive that we have so many deputies and senators for a state of 10 million people. But on the other side, I would say we have a very good experience with these systems. That this system is very stable. So if you won't completely change the political system, if something wrong should happen, Sedate could break the could provide a balance with that what happens in the Chamber of Deputies. And there is also a stable representation in the Senate because the senators are not elected in one time, but each every 2 years, 27 seats are changing. So this is something about the Czech Parliament, about the Czech Constitution. Now we are coming to the discussion. Tomorrow I would like to speak about the position of the Czech Republic in the Visegrad group. It's quite a complicated topic. Then I would like to speak about the subnational government in the Czech Republic, what is very important for democracy, so about regions and about the municipalities. And I would also like to speak about the party politics, about different positions. And the party politics is something what is very complicated in the Czech Republic right now after the parliament elections. And probably we will come also to the positions of the Czech political parties on that, what happens in the world, included Ukraine. So last call for questions. You have a question? So you have a question? I have the impression you want to ask something? Not today. Okay, so tomorrow. I thank once more to Professors Shevchuk and Lebeduk for the invitation. See you tomorrow. We will continue tomorrow. Thank you for attention.
Thank you.